right, so as Dr. Rose said, my name is Tyler Reid, and today I'm going to be talking about doxycycline and its effects on the family of human prion diseases known as transmissible spongiform encephalopathies, or TSEs. And the main question that I'm going to try and answer with this presentation today is, does doxycycline have a positive impact on patient condition and prognosis? And that may be a bit of a simple question to ask with a senior seminar, but in this case it's pretty necessary because one of the lack of evidence that's out there right now referring to doxycycline and TSEs, and there's some conflict within the evidence. So we're going to talk about that later on, and to begin we're going to start with the prion protein itself and explain what that is and how it relates to these TSEs. The prion protein is a protein that's seen throughout the human body. It's expressed in many of its tissues, and also seen across many different species of mammals. It's a peripheral membrane glycoprotein that has some suspected functions related to anti-apoptotic activity and neuroprotection. And I say suspected functions because there's no definite signaling pathway or protein-protein interactions that have been identified as of yet to concretely link the protein to these functions. But what we have seen is in full knockdown of the PRNP gene on chromosome 20, which encodes for this protein. There's full lethality in the animal models that's been tested in, as well as more specifically, preventing the most common proteolytic cleavage of prion protein in homeostatic conditions, which is the N1 fragment of the alpha cleavage, results in an increase in pro-apoptotic activity and chronic demyelination neuropathy in mice. So that's how we know that these proteins at least remotely relate to those functions that we're talking about. So as I said earlier, it's observed in most animals. That's what allows us to use test species like mice and ruminants to study this. On the top right-hand part of the screen, you can see that there's a helpful diagram of the protein itself. I'm going to point out two regions on that diagram that are important to carry forward, one being this green region in the middle titled HC. That stands for the hydrophobic core of the protein. Typically, it's hidden within this group of alpha helices in the 3D model. And to the right of that hydrophobic core, we have a large PK-resistant fragment, PK standing for protein kinase. So this large fragment is protein kinase resistant, and in homeostatic conditions is typically hidden within the outer domains of that protein. And this table down here, I'm going to revisit after this next slide, which is talking about TSEs. TSEs are a family of fatal neurodegenerative disorders seen in humans, and they're caused due to a conformational change to the prion protein from its physiologic formation to what's called the PRPSC isoform, or which stands for prion protein scrapping. And it's called that because scrapping is a chronic wasting disease seen in sheep, which is where this prion protein was first discovered. Where these diseases were first discovered. So that's why it's named after that. And these diseases are characterized by the formation of amyloid fibrils and plaques within the neural tissue, which is something that it actually shares with Alzheimer's disease, although the proteins that make up those plaques are a little bit different. And the four recognized diseases of the human TSEs are Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, Gerstmann-Strauss-Shanker disease, and fatal familial insomnia and Kuru. But we're going to only talk about the first three because Kuru is actually almost eradicated, and it's only seen in a subpopulation of tribes in Papua New Guinea, so it doesn't really relate to modern, well, it does relate to modern medicine, but not this doxycycline research as it's going forward. So where this comes into play with the prion protein, of course the prions are the infective agent that caused these diseases. But back to that previous table, we see a comparison between the cellular prion protein homeostatic conformation and the scrappy prion protein, the infected isoform. And in cellular conditions, you see that it is rich in alpha helices, it's soluble, it's sensitive to these protein kinases, and does not aggregate together. But when you have an infective prion isoform present, those are rich in beta sheets, which reveal those hydrophobic core and protein kinase resistant regions, causing it to be insoluble in solution. resistant protein kinases and more apt to aggregate together in bunches. And that goes down into the etiology and pathology of these diseases. With Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, Gerstenstrahl-Smith-Scheinker, and fatal familial insomnia, the avenue by which they operate is fairly consistent. It starts off with the contact with diseased tissue. It can be through ingestion due to exposure with medical instruments or spontaneous misfolding. When I say ingestion, I'm not just saying ingestion of brain tissue, although that can be a route, I guess, but ingestion of any tissue, because remember, these proteins are expressed throughout the whole organism. This is where the big scare with mad cow disease came from, because mad cow disease is bovine spongiform encephalopathy. It's the same disease, just in a different species. And the word was, by ingesting diseased tissue, you could then contract a TSE, which actually led to about 200 cases in the UK of human TSEs due to infected tissue. Exposure to medical instruments, that is specifically in the case of a surgery done on a patient that is positive for a TSE, and those instruments not being cleaned correctly. These prions are very hardy and resistant proteins, and if you throw instruments in an autoclave, they'll denature and heat, but as soon as that heat is removed, they'll renature in a disinfective isoform. So those tools need to be cleaned very carefully to prevent the deposition of these prions into the next patient those tools are used on. And spontaneous misfolding, that can occur either just through an accident in regular cellular metabolism and homeostasis, or due to a genetic predisposition. Now, once you have this infective prion present, you have what's referred to as the prion or PLPSC cascade and protein kinase resistance. Now, this cascade that I'm talking about refers to the fact that these infective prions are autocatalytic, meaning that once you have one present, it'll interact with a healthy prion protein and cause it to misfold in the same way that the infected prion protein is. So then you have a cascading effect where you have an exponential increase of these infective isoforms. And due to the fact that these proteins are protein kinase resistant, your body's natural mechanisms of breaking proteins down, proteasomes and the unfolded protein response can't really deal well with them. So you have an overabundance of these infective isoforms, which leads to amyloid plaque formation. And this is because the cells can't handle the amount of unfolded prion protein and push it out of the cell where they aggregate together and cause neurotoxicity. Now, because the prion protein's function relates to anti-apoptotic activity and neuroprotection, once you don't have that protein operating as it should, you have an increase in pro-apoptotic signaling that kills the cells surrounding the plaque, which then goes into the neural degeneration characterized by formation of spongiform lesions. The cells living around this amyloid plaque then die and cause a pit to form within the neural tissue, which on scans looks like little pockets, as you can see in the sponge. So that's where the name comes from. This is a diagram that shows how that protein cascade works. On the left side of the screen here, we have a healthy cellular prion protein and an infectious isoform, and those can interact together in equilibrium to form a healthy and effective prion protein heterodimer. And as that progresses, you can actually have an effective protein dimer form. And as more healthy proteins interact with this dimer, you can have an oligomer form, which then goes on to a protofibril. And that protofibril can join with other protofibrils and form an amyloid fibril or amyloid plaque, or it can break apart further and associate with other healthy proteins, causing this cascade effect. And where that becomes an issue, again, is with neurotoxicity. So when you have this fibril or aggregation of infective isoforms interacting with healthy prion protein on the surface of a cell, it can inhibit its anti-apoptotic activity or send an outright pro-apoptotic signal, which causes cell death. Now, on this left side of the screen, we have some cellular mechanisms to defend against this. One hypothesis is that shedding the prion protein prevents it from aggregating with this amyloid fibril plaque, although that hasn't been proven. And recent evidence has shown that that may not be the case. It may still be able to be switched over that infected isoform. But this N1 fragment is actually the product of that proteolytic cleavage, alpha cleavage that I spoke about earlier, which prevents or acts in neuroprotection, and downregulating that can result in pro-apoptotic signaling and that product demyelination neuropathy. So one guess is this fragment here may work to bind to the amyloid fibrils and prevent them from associating with healthy fine proteins, preventing disease progression. So now that we've talked about the etiology and the pathology of those diseases, I'm going to touch on each one of the three that I'm going to talk about today. First being Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, or CJD. It's the most common of these TSEs, and it happens in four common forms, being sporadic CJD, or SCJD, variant CJD, which is caused by the introduction of infected prions through ingestion, genetic CJD, or iatrogenic CJD. And what characterizes CJD compared to the other two diseases that I'll talk about is that residue 129 on the protein is highly variable due to genetic differences. And those mutations can arise spontaneously or be passed down by parents. CJD comprises 85% of all TSE cases. And even if that is a large percentage of all the cases, in itself it is still a rare disease, only happening about 1 per 1 million people. And it's characterized by a rapid onset of dementia, myoclonus, and then akinetic mutism, which means that you can't speak. You're just there. So not some fun stuff. Next is Gerson-Strasser-Shaka disease, or GSS. And it is primarily associated with a P102L mutation of the PRNP gene, which results in a proline to leucine change and residue 129 protein. It's characterized by autosomal dominant inheritance, meaning that it only needs one genetic mutation to cause the disease, meaning that if you have a parent heterozygous for the disease, you have a 50% chance of inheriting it yourself. If you have a parent that's homozygous for it, you're guaranteed to have it as well. It's characterized also by a slower disease progression, usually lasting 2 to 10 years post-diagnosis, compared to 6 to 12 months in the other TSEs. And this is hypothesized to be associated with a different prion isoform that's still infected, but not as aggressive in how it aggregates. And in this diagram to the right here, you see an arrow and a bracketed region. The bracketed region highlights one of the characteristic signs of GSS that differentiate it from CJD or FFI, and that is a multicentric amyloid plaque. Now, it may look like a circle, but if that picture is blown up, you'd see many different spheres comprising that same plaque. And that's behavior from prions that's only seen in GSS. And what the arrow is pointing to, it's a little faint, but there's a white pocket there that's actually one of those spongiform lesions I was referring to earlier. The last disease is fatal familial insomnia, and it's associated with a D178N mutation of the PRNP gene, causing aspartic acid to asparagine change in the protein. And what makes this unique different than GSS or CJD is that neurodegeneration is usually restricted to the thalamus and the basal nuclei, meaning that those are the areas that are breaking down the most, and you see a disruption of the circadian rhythm, the normal sleep-wake cycle, followed by hallucinations, and then dysautonomia and sympathetic overactivity. So your autonomic nervous system isn't working correctly, and your sympathetic nervous system is overactive, causing an increase in heart rate, high blood pressure, and things associated with the sympathetic nervous system. So how does doxycycline work with these diseases? Well, doxycycline is an antibiotic that actually works by binding to bacterial ribosomes, prevents them from creating proteins. But in 2000, Tagliavani and their research group found that doxycycline binds very tightly to these infected prion isoforms, and that started the wheel to turn, and more researchers going into this to see what that meant for these TSEs. And then in 2004, Merrick and her research group found that doxycycline was linked to neuroprotection in mice with MS, ALS, and HD Huntington disease. And that led to more research in animal models that led to doxycycline being approved as a trial drug for TSEs in 2007. And in 2008 showed the first association between doxycycline and TSEs being CJD. And that Dale Luigi and her research group found that it significantly increased the survival of Syrian hamsters infected with CJD. So, all this research led to the first clinical trial for doxycycline with TSEs in 2014, led by Stefan Heik and his research group out of Germany. And they held a randomized double-blind placebo-controlled study evaluating doxycycline's effects on CJD. They included 121 patients in this study, and it occurred over 6 years across both Italy and France. And the patients were administered 100 milligrams of doxycycline orally once per day from the start of symptoms to patient expiration. And the results of that study, here you can see we have some survival curves, and I'll just orient you these graphs real quick. The top two and bottom left graph represent intention to treat populations, which mean that they weren't able to follow the protocol exactly due to some unknown obstacle. Most commonly in these patients, they develop dysphagia associated with their neurodegeneration, meaning they couldn't swallow the pills anymore. So they were administered doxycycline intravenously instead. But since that wasn't according to protocol, they were moved to this intention to treat population. This is the total intention to treat population here, and that's further split into the intention to treat population from Italy and France. And then the bottom right corner represents the per protocol population from both countries. The y-axis of the graph represents the percentage of the patients left. X-axis is time. And if you look at all of these graphs, and the median survival time, which is signified by 50%, there is virtually no distinction between the treated and untreated groups in their survivability. So that is not good news for doxycycline. That shows that there's really no association between taking a drug and prolonged patient survivability. This graph further delineates the per protocol graph, and is specifically related to patients in Italy. And on the right-hand side, second to last column, duration of treatment, that is the easiest way to see which patients were treated. And these are from the double-blind study. And you can see that there really is no association between doxycycline administration and increased patient outcome. And moving on to the same table, signifying patients from France, you can see the same thing. There's clinical onset to death duration there, and doxycycline administration here, and there still is no statistic correlation between doxycycline administration and increased patient survivability. So, what does that mean moving on? Well, doxycycline didn't have any effects on these patients statistically, but one thing that the researchers did come away with is advanced disease progression may mask the therapeutic effects of doxycycline due to the nature of neurodegenerative diseases. Once you lose brain tissue, you're not getting it back. And once symptoms occur, symptoms aren't going to alleviate. So is doxycycline being masked by the symptoms? And is there a point in the disease at which doxycycline may be working, but it has no viewable effect? Another thing that they wanted to look further into is if doxycycline has a different effect on the different isoforms of the prion protein formed by codon 129 genotype. And lastly, doxycycline's effectiveness and related to its concentration within the brain tissue is something that the research group wanted to address further, and is something that still needs to be addressed further. But this study did lead to another clinical trial in 2016 by Daniela Varias and her research group. They built their study the same way as Stefan Heik and his group, with one exception. They narrowed the inclusion criteria to try and find patients that were earlier on in disease progression. They took special care to analyze the codon 129 polymorphism in these patients and how doxycycline affected that. And here is what they came up with. So here's a survival curve from that study. As you can see, the red line is the observational study. I should have mentioned that. They did run an observational study along with a placebo-controlled study, just due to the fact that patients that were earlier on in disease progression were less apt to agree to be a part of the placebo-controlled randomized study because they wanted the treatment. So in the placebo-controlled study, they only had 13 participants, but in the observational study, they had around 90. And in both the observational, which is the solid line, and the placebo-controlled, which is the dashed line, you see significant increase in patient survivability at the median, 50%. So with the observational study, we have 50% of participants lasting 400 days or more, and non-treated landing just around 300 days. And another thing to notice is on the left side of the graph, there is the hazard ratio. The previous study conducted by Stefan Haidt had a hazard ratio of 1, meaning that treated patients were no more likely to have a deleterious effect or event rather than the non-treated population. But in this study, the total hazard ratio is 0.633, meaning that treated patients were 36.7% less likely to have an adverse event than non-treated patients, that adverse event being death. So that was a significant finding as well. Further on, they analyzed codon 129 polymorphism, and for a double valine and heterozygous methionine valine genotype, there was no significant difference, but in a methionine homozygosity, there's a significant increase in patient duration to the tune of, I believe, 200%. So, what does this mean? Treatment groups in both the observational and double-blind studies saw a significant increase to patient clinical outcome. In the observational treatment group, they survived a median of 400 days compared to around 200 days. And in the double-blind study, they survived a median of 100 days compared to 50 days. And doxycycline seemed to have a profound effect on patients with the double-blind polymorphism at codon 129. And while these results should be taken with heed just because the placebo-controlled study only had 13 participants, this observation with the double-blind polymorphism was conducted out of the observational trial and had about 40 individuals fitting this category. So, overall, these conclusions lead us to think that doxycycline is trending towards being an effective anti-prion drug in these TSEs. Much research is still needed to be conducted because these two clinical trials are the only two clinical trials that have yet to be completed. And doxycycline's effects on the disease still may be severely stymied by advanced disease progressions, which makes researchers think that may be more fitted towards prophylactic treatment with patients genetically predisposed to these TSEs. And again, further research is still needed to determine the effects of doxycycline's concentration in neural tissue on the overall effectiveness against TSEs. Some things that are actually being currently researched that affect these conclusions is relating to the idea that doxycycline may be geared more towards a prophylactic treatment with genetic predispositions. There's actually a diagnostic method using modified PET scanning that may include doxycycline to be a treatment for patients with sporadic TSEs due to the fact that these researchers are anticipating being able to catch a TSE a year in advance before symptoms arise, which compared to the normal current standard real-time quaking use conversion, which involves having to have symptoms arise and then they do a painful spinal tap on the patient and analyze the cerebrospinal fluid for prion seeding and aggregation. You don't really want to do that unless the patient's already showing symptoms. So that's one thing to look out for in the future. And secondly, there's currently a 10-year double-blind placebo-controlled study going on in patients with fatal familial insomnia. There's about 70 individuals from one extended family that agreed to be a part of the study and have been administered doxycycline orally, 100 milligrams, for the past 6 years, and I believe the study is due to be finished and data analyzed in the year 2022. So that may have a profound effect on doxycycline's consideration as a prophylactic treatment for these TSEs. And here is my reference slide. Are there any questions?
Tyler, can you maybe speak to the difference between TSC in humans and mad cow disease? Are they similar or are they different?
Different in the way that TSCs affect humans and mad cow disease affects cows. So they operate the same way. It's the same protein that is dysfunctional and causing these amyloid plaques to form. And neurotoxicity is seen in both of them. So that's why there was concern over TSEs being caused by the ingestion of infected material and tissue from the cow disease.
What is the prognosis for fatal familial insomnia?
It's invariably fatal.
Okay.
So there's no cure, and typically prognosis is similar to CJD, and then patients only last about 6 to 12 months following diagnosis.
How affordable would the treatment be?
Doxycycline is a very common antibiotic. I believe that the cost for a 100 pill bottle is just around $32, so it's very affordable. And even if it doesn't cure the disease, some case studies have shown up to 4 years of survival of the patient following regular doxycycline treatment. But again, that's just a case study. There's no p-values associated with that. It's not really statistically significant.
Do the FFI patients, do they seem to be, I don't even see how long they're expected to live, are they? Is that
still 6 to 12 months, just like CJ.
So, okay, did you say they're doing a 10-year case study on anything?
Yes, that 6 to 12 months following diagnosis.
Okay.
Since FFI is strictly a genetic disease, when symptoms arise varies between individuals. I think the median for symptoms actually arising is about 52 years old. So they've taken all these individuals from one extended family and decided to prophylactically treat them with doxycycline before they even have symptoms to see if they can prolong that asymptomatic state. Because they're guaranteed to have the disease, it's just a question of when that starts. Because FFI is characterized by the production of these infectious prions. It just makes them more apt to have a spontaneous misfolding that causes them. But it's invariably fatal in the fact that that genetic mutation does eventually cause an infectious prion.
Do you have any questions for Reid?